Teammate LeBron James says he prays on Dellavedova.
Like he made a steal or something. If it's a ball on the ground, he's going to be the first guy to the ground. He showed it multiple times tonight. He's huge. He's huge for our team. He gives us that grit. That grit that we need.
Another 5AA forecast, sunny today, 15. Tomorrow, partly cloudy, 17. Saturday, cloudy and 19. A possible shower for Sunday, 20. Then a possible shower for Monday and Tuesday, tops in the high teens. More news as it happens on 5AA.
1395, Adelaide's 5AA. This is Peter Godfrey.
And a very good morning to you, 8 past 5. It is a chilly old morning this morning. We haven't hit our expected overnight minimum yet, but we may well do before too long. 4.6 degrees is in the city at the moment, but cooler elsewhere down at the airport. It's 3 degrees. Mount Lofty, it's 2 degrees. I think northern suburbs, quite cool. Parafield, 0.5 of a degree at the moment. And Roseworthy's been the coldest all night. Roseworthy's come up 4 degrees there. it's warmer than it was. So Parafield's about the coldest spot at the moment. So, yes, very chilly. Let's head across the ditch. Maybe it's a bit warmer there. Find out what's happening in New Zealand. Selwyn Manning, editor of eveningreport.nz. Selwyn, how's things your side of the ditch?
Yeah, not too bad, Peter. It's, winter temperatures. Not as cold as you guys at the moment. I'm speaking from the Auckland region. So
yeah.
It's very damp. You know, it's been a lot of rain. The ground is absolutely saturated. While you were on holiday, Peter, there was some significant floods, particularly down in Dunedin in the south of the South Island. That was, huge. You know, the city itself got something like just over 100 millimetres of rain over the period of 24 hours. So that's a big downpour.
Yeah, I mean, you know, here where we it takes us a couple of months to get that kind of a rainfall reading. It just, you know, the mind boggles to think of that much rain all at once. Amazing stuff. Yeah.
But you were enjoying yourself over in
Australia. Yes,
very. It was all going down.
Very warm. That was the nice thing, although very humid. But yeah, sort of 29, 30 degrees for the 8 days we were there. Beautiful. Yeah, lovely food. Enjoyed the food. Ooh,
yeah.
We ate well. That's for sure.
Oh, that's the way, isn't it?
Yeah.
A midwinter break.
Yes. No, very nice. But always good to get back home and, you know, back to your normal routine as well. You can't stay on holidays forever as much as we'd like to.
Yeah, true. Yeah. Save that for another day, maybe.
Exactly. Exactly right. All right. Well, we've got some interesting things to talk about with you this morning. Now, firstly, this is an interesting one. Live sheep exports. Now, it's a rather contentious issue here as well because, of course, we export cattle and sheep to many places, Middle Eastern countries. But curiously, you've got a live sheep and cattle export heading out from New Zealand soon, yet you've got a ban on live exports. But there is a loophole.
Yeah, this is right. You know, just when New Zealanders thought that it had been relegated to history, these live sheep exports, the National Ed Government has approved the export of 50,000 sheep in one ship. And they'll be topped up with 3,000 cattle. Now, they're heading to Mexico, Peter. It's the largest mass export of livestock to ever leave New Zealand shores on one vessel at one time. Yesterday, that's Wednesday, of course, the workers, they began loading the sheep into the vessel and cattle as well. The ship is called, the carrier ship apparently is the proper terminology for it, and it's called the NADA, N-A-D-A. Now, back in 2007, New Zealand had banned live sheep exports. Everybody thought that it was banning all sheep exports, but where the sheep, apparently what it banned was where the sheep are destined and they're exported for slaughter. That was banned.
Yeah.
Now apparently this massive sheep export that's going on at the moment is to restock breeding stock in Mexico after Mexico suffered thousands and thousands of sheep and cattle died in a severe drought. And the government's Ministry of Primary Industries has approved this mass export, citing that loophole, meaning that these sheep, the cattle that's on board, 50,000 sheep, 3,000 cattle, are heading to Mexico. The intention is that they will not be slaughtered at their destination, so therefore the loophole is in place.
Oh.
So that's the difference here. And that's caused a lot of problems here relating to animal welfare and animal rights groups citing this as just not right, that the purpose for banning live sheep exports to the Middle East, like you cited, Australia has done things like that. New Zealand was a big exporter to the Middle East, to Iran, etc., that the inhumane conditions on the ships getting there was one of the main reasons why they were banned. It's what, you know, the group Sable Animals from Exploitation, or known by its acronym SAFE. Now, Hans Krieg, the leader of that, and here's a direct quote from him. He says, "In a shipment this large, many animals will die on the journey. Sheep die. They refuse." Oh, he says it's a refusal to eat the dry nuts fed on the ship. So it's it must be, you know, the conditions on the ship, whether or not they're being contained for such a long period of time, squeezed in shoulder to shoulder kind of thing, that they're not getting the opportunity to get their balance, if you like, or the equilibrium, you know, seasickness, I suppose, puts them off their food, and fatalities and come from that stress that they're under. The government officials, they insist that during the two-week voyage, the exporter must meet requirements around water, food, space and facilities. So those are more general comments. They also say that the sheep must be accompanied by a suitable experienced stockman and at least one veterinarian. Now, we know from radio reports earlier this morning, Peter, on Radio New Zealand, one of the people representing the interests of those sending the sheep across to Mexico, he was on the radio and he admitted that there's only one vet for the whole 50,000 sheep on board. Obviously, there's a lot of workers feeding out. That's what he was accentuating, that element of it, saying, you know, there's a big team around that vet. But at the same time, one vet on board for 50,000 sheep seems like the ratio is not too flash. The Green Party here, Peter, animal welfare spokesperson Mojo Mathers, now she said in a quote here, "This is a huge number of animals that need to be looked after, fed and watered properly and humanely in confined quarters for a long journey," end of quote. Now, she's obviously stating the obvious of the concerns that are there, and I think inside the Kiwi kind of culture, there's also a concern there that this is big export, and there's no guarantees that once the breeding stock has bred, that they won't be slaughtered. So is this a loophole or is it legitimate? And those are the big questions, I guess. And no doubt they're the same kind of questions that Australians kind of can face when this kind of issue is raised.
Indeed. So is it sort of anybody sort of raised the issue of whether that this loophole, if that's what it is to be challenged and legislation tightened up? Is there calls for that to be looked at?
There hasn't at this stage, and it seems like the pressures are coming from a more lobby approach and one of sentiment and value.
Yeah.
So that would be interesting. As far as the shipment is concerned, it's well and truly scheduled to go in the next few days. They're loading fast at the moment down Timaru Port, which is in the South Island. So these are South Island sheep that are going across there. Winter conditions and going obviously up into the northern hemisphere, there'll be a huge difference in temperatures. It'll be interesting, I suppose, to put it in a cold sense, to see actually what the state of the sheep will be once they get there, and also from the point of view of how they can sustain, how are they going to adjust to that kind of climate up there?
Yeah, and whether any die on the voyage over, I guess.
Yeah, and die on the voyage over, which, you know, this is the big thing that caught Kiwis back here with the live sheep exports. Slaughter to the Middle East was, there was recorded video and recorded images of that was circulating from on board some of these ships back in the 2000s, showing just absolutely dire conditions. Now, we all know that our countries are export countries. We all know that the benefits come back to the economy and the people via these kind of things. But it was seen in balance in 2007 when the Labor-led government was in, that it was not a sustainable practice from the point of view of humanity, or humane practice. And there was also a shift through the 1990s and 2000s, where into New Zealand's regulatory system relating to its animal husbandry, its caring for animals, farming animals, and exporting of animals, that there was an acknowledgement beyond, and this is an interesting part of the legalities, Peter, beyond the welfare of an animal, but one where rights of an animal were starting to actually be considered. And stuff that I've wrote about myself back in the early 90s, about the bleeding industry in New Zealand, bleeding animals and selling their blood, and that was a contentious issue that developed from that particular story as well. But the rights aspect is an interesting legal issue that is raised.
Yeah. Indeed. No doubt many here will be following this with interest as it unfolds. As I said, it's been, you know, live exports of ours have been very contentious in recent times. Even there was another issue raised this week in regard to it. So, interesting. Mm. So we'll just have a quick break and come back. Some sad news regarding one of your noted and most respected defence lawyers. So we'll take a look at this man and his legacy in a moment with you. Thanks, Ewan. Be right back. Ewan Manning with us, editor of eveningreport.nz.
5AA Breakfast.
Premier, thank you for your time. A lot of people were questioning the wisdom of spending $160 million on the Oban and saying that if the government's so hard-pressed for cash, maybe it could look at shelving a project such as that instead.
I mean, in the scheme of things, there's a relatively modest cost.
Look, Premier, I've got to say, you really are underestimating the public anger.
David Penberthy, Mark Aston and Jane Riley. Weekday mornings from 6 on 1395. Adelaide's 5AA.
Right now, Toyota Material Handling has a great offer on forklift rentals. Rent any forklift for 6 weeks or more and get an extra week's rent free. It could save you hundreds. Toyota Material Handling is Australia's number one in new and used forklift sales, short or long-term forklift hire and all forklift servicing. Call Toyota Material Handling now on 1-800-425-438 or visit toyotamaterialhandling.com.au.
Terms and conditions apply. Offer ends August 31.
Big games, big events, big impact. Big Screen Video are the people behind some of the biggest screens you've ever seen. Big Screen Video specialise in getting people's attention and keeping it with their range of indoor, outdoor and mobile LED screens, signs and scoreboards. Big Screen Video LED screens. For a big impact, visit bigscreenvideo.com.au. Because size does matter.
At Goodyear Auto Care, we don't just care about your tyres. We look after the whole car. That's why we're called Goodyear Auto Care. With 30 years' experience, Marco and his team of fully qualified mechanics really look after their customers, including logbook servicing. Your cars may change, but when we get to know you, where you drive and how much, we can anticipate wear and tear. And that's what makes the difference. Goodyear Auto Care. Crossroad Hawthorne, Richmond Road, Richmond and Northeast Road, Hampstead Gardens.
Aussie, Aussie, Aussie! Aussie Ripper Roasts!
Now, if I said to you Aussie Ripper Roasts have over 35 years of combined experience, what would you say?
Ripper!
And they're SA and family owned.
Ripper!
And they'll cater for all occasions.
Oh, ripper!
Corporate, weddings, birthdays, engagements, christenings, sporting club.
Ripper!
For your next event, give Aussie Ripper Roasts a call. Here we go. You know the drill.
Aussie, Aussie, Aussie! Aussie Ripper Roasts!
AussieRipperRoasts.com.au.
Peter Godfrey on 1395, Adelaide's 5AA.
And we're casting our eyes across the ditch to New Zealand. Ewan Manning, editor of eveningreport.nz, is with us. Now, Ewan, the passing of a noted, respected and perhaps at times controversial, would that be the right word to describe him? Sir Peter Williams QC has passed away.
Yes, really sad situation. I mean, Sir Peter Williams QC. I mean, his name, Peter, is a household name around New Zealand and has been for many decades. He defended some of New Zealand's most notorious criminals over his career. His career spanned 60 years. Sir Peter passed away on Tuesday at the age of around 80. Now, he defended, for example, like you said, controversial cases, certainly notorious criminals, but defended others as well that were unjustly accused. And he represented, for example, Ronald Jorgensen, who was convicted for the Bassett Road machine gun murders in Auckland in the late 1960s. Now, that was, you know, by the sheer nature of that crime was notorious in New Zealand, and also the complexities around that particular case and using secret witnesses, et cetera, were very controversial. And Sir Peter, as he was knighted earlier this year for his works to the legal fraternity, really was able to, even though Ronald Jorgensen was convicted of that, he stayed true to the complexities in the case. One of a confession that Jorgensen had made, but under police duress and under police brutality. So, you know, those kind of things were big. He also helped defend, well, he was the main defence lawyer for Terry Clark, also known as Alexander Sinclair, and he was the leader of the Mr. Asia heroin syndicate that was plaguing, you know, with its distribution of heroin, plaguing New Zealand, but significantly and most significantly Australia in the 1970s. Mm. Now, he represented Terry Clark as his lawyer, and also he helped the defence team. This is a very significant one here, representing Arthur Allen Thomas, who was twice found guilty for the murders of Jeanette and Harvey Croon. Any Kiwis in your audience this morning, Peter, that were around New Zealand around the late 1960s, early 70s, would know the Crew murders and Arthur Thomas. It was such a big case and remains controversial to this day. Now, Arthur Thomas, he was released and had his convictions for that double murder pardoned after it was found that police had planted evidence to force a conviction. And he served 9 years in maximum security prison, Arthur Thomas did. And Sir Peter Williams, he was one of those that helped to have justice served in that particular case. But Sir Peter was also, he was renowned for his work seeking improvements for people held in police custody and also for prisoners serving time in New Zealand's prisons. He campaigned and was often very successful in getting the authorities to observe the human rights of prisoners. Peter, when I've interviewed him, you know, a few times, I suppose, and he was always able to speak with experience, as you would imagine, a real authority about the conditions that people were in when they were locked up. Mm. He was very, very hard very firm is a better word, on saying that if you lock people up without hope, nor opportunity, without any rehabilitative programs designed to help the person to reach their potential, their positive potential, then that not only were we failing the prisoner, but we were failing all of ourselves as well. That he believed that if a person was in prison, they ought to exit prison at a time where and basically be rehabilitated as much as possible. His work in that area was for the Howard League of Penal Reform, and he was a significant mover where to get some common sense into it, not just to lock people up and, you know, the punitive elements of the prison system come into force, but to regard people as humans, that the conditions of their lives and their choices that they made had often led to crimes, but the human was still there, and that human's rights should be observed. A marvellous man, available, some marvellous kind of times that people had enjoyed through the public eye with Peter Williams.
Was he ever seen as perhaps, or did people try to portray him as perhaps being soft on crime because he was, you know, focused on, I guess, the rights of prisoners? Was he ever seen in that light?
He wasn't really, and this is the remarkable side of the man, because he is a no-nonsense kind of guy. He wasn't in your face, but he was just so eloquent and firm in his resolve that if the crime was committed and the person was guilty, then there were consequences that person had to face. But what he was talking about was things like those consequences ought not lead to their suicide. Yep. They ought not lead to their deaths in custody. They had a human right to basically survive in this country's penal system. There was a spate in the 1990s, for example, where spate of suicides in police prisons and also in the prison system as well. But the police cells part was something that I was looking at myself and writing a feature kind of piece on it for one of the newspapers. And Peter, he just hit it. Not only did he know the cases of everyone I raised relating to the suicides of these young people, he also knew the backstory. He spoke in detail about the course of their lives and getting there. And when you've got a 15-year-old child, basically, sitting in a police cell, a hostile environment, secluded from anything, nothing at all, that the risks of suicide are so high. And he spoke very, very persuasively, without sounding like he was a wet flannel, about the responsibility of the state to protect these people, not only from others, but also from themselves. He also spoke very persuasively, Peter, that in his view, and he had witnessed it as a defence lawyer, going into the cells, speaking with these people, that he said, in many cases, you get a hardened gangster, gets into the system, they're suddenly away from, you know, whatever the support mechanisms that they feel around the gang structure, and they're on their own, that emotionally they regress and often regress to a state where they they're years younger than they are in year terms. Now, he wasn't being soft on that, but he was saying the responsibility is on the state and all of us to make sure that those people are able to sustain their lives, to live, basically,
and to
serve their time. It was a persuasive argument. Mm. It wasn't, I guess, you know, we kind of see such arguments through it. Oh, they must be pigeonholed into a civil libertarian and very, very, very light on the sentencing and trying to minimise that. It wasn't, to the contrary. He was talking about the rights and justice.
Yeah, it's a basic human rights. Remarkable man. Your final interview with Sir Peter, you've got up on your website too, I see.
Mm. Yeah, that was over the GCSB, or the Government Communications Security Bureau. Now, it was back in 2012 where information was surfacing on the government spies, basically, operating outside their legal perimeters, operating illegally in their surveillance of the internet tycoon Kim.com. Now, there was complexities around that legalities at that time of the interview, and there was also complexities around whether or not a very senior police officer had perjured himself in the High Court. Now, those questions required a legal mind really like Sir Peter to unpick the details and the subtleties of the law. In his view, the police got off the hook. The police officer got off the hook on whether or not he had or he had not perjured himself over trying to mask that a government but department, a secret one, had been operating in that case. Because, in Peter's view, the judge did not press the issue. He says that was a major failure, and also the defence lawyer of Kim.com did not hone in on it enough and adequately enough to actually serve justice on raising that question of whether or not perjury had taken place. So retrospective evaluation on it, he said it may be fine that the public comes to that view themselves, but the specifics of the questioning let the public interest down. It was marvellous exchanges. And you know, after that interview, for example, it's a credit to the man. You know, as journalists, you know, you'd know, Peter, that you often, you know, you're just a mere communicator that receives information. About 2 weeks after, I got in the mail a copy of his book, signed, and also a letter in there, you know, thanking me for the professionalism of the interview and things like that. He's just a marvellous kind of guy. Yeah. I thought, what a man, you know, decent guy.
Indeed. Many thanks for joining us on the program this morning, Selwyn. Have a great week. We'll catch you again same time next week, but of course on breakfast tomorrow morning, just after 6:30.
Okay, please.
Take all the best. Thanks, Selwyn. Selwyn Manning, editor of eveningreport.nz.
This is Adelaide's 5AA.
Sunny and 15 today. It's 5:31. I'm Anne Stone. The twin brother of the man charged with raping and murdering New South Wales teacher Stephanie Scott will also be charged over her death in April. Marcus Stanford was arrested yesterday at Forreston in the Adelaide Hills, and he'll be extradited to New South Wales this morning to face court there. He's accused of dumping incriminating material sent to him by his brother in the mail. And Vincent Stanford is accused of sexually assaulting and murdering Miss Scott on Easter Sunday in the town of Leeton. Tram drivers will walk off the job for 4 hours today as they continue to dispute pay and work conditions. Trams will be off the tracks between 10 a.m. and 2 p.m. with passengers to use substitute buses. And Transport Minister Stephen Mulligan says they'll continue negotiating with the union to resolve the issues.
What we've said is that we're willing to negotiate around a couple of their sticking points. So the government's prepared to move. They indicated a willingness to me that they are keen to negotiate around their points. So I think we are a little closer together than where we were.
A man has died after being shot in Melbourne's southeast yesterday. Alicia Byrne has details.
Police and ambulance officers were called to Bloomfield Street, Keysborough, around 6:15 yesterday.